Hi all, I'm Carrie and welcome back to my channel. I'm a geologist and I love costume dramas, especially ones involving rocks and women geologists. So Frances Lee's 2020 film, Ammonite, appealed to me on multiple levels, or layers. Lee stated in interviews that he did not want to do a biopic, but then why do a film about real historical people? Instead, he wanted to make a film highlighting the beautiful romantic relationships that we know from the historical record existed between women during the Victorian era. And I presume he chose Mary Anning because she's not super well known, because he liked the scenery in Lyme, and fossils just make everything more interesting. As someone who has read everything I can about Mary Anning, a woman after my own heart, I can say there is not enough evidence about her sexuality one way or another, or another, or another. So, given that lesbian relationships did exist in the past, before the word lesbian was used as it is today, that Mary Anning's sexuality is ambiguous, and that the importance of representation of different sexualities in films, especially about the past when there was so little contemporary representation, I think the portrayal of such a relationship in Ammonite is laudable. As Kate Winslet said on The View, she and Frances were bringing Mary's story to life in their own way. And director Frances Lee asked, quote, "After seeing queer history routinely straightened throughout culture and given the historical figure, where there is no evidence whatsoever of a heterosexual relationship, is it not permissible to view that person within another context?" Well, certainly. My hope is that Kate and Saoirse's participation in this film will get more people to watch it and become curious about Mary Anning and Charlotte Murchison. And maybe that's what led you here. Both of these women made important contributions to geology, which was really just becoming a popular science in the early 19th century when they met. But while Ammonite hints at some of Mary's involvement, it totally glosses over Charlotte's. I teach historical geology and spend a few weeks each semester covering the history of this science and the mostly rich white men who started it, most of them doing so as sort of a hobby on the side. None of the textbooks available mention the women who helped and encouraged their husbands, fathers, and other male relatives, or provided key fossil samples that caused their scientific careers to take off. So I make it a point to bring up the women, particularly Mary Anning, and discuss why they are not as famous as their male counterparts, and why the women deserve, at minimum, blurbs in geology textbooks and discussion in science classes, so a more diverse cadre of students can see themselves in the history of this science and potentially its future. Therefore, as a woman geologist and teacher, my purpose in this video is to expand on many of the historical Easter eggs in the film to better flesh out Mary and Charlotte and the history of geological investigation in Lyme. Here we go. The film begins with one of Mary Anning's finds in a museum, where a man replaces the card indicating she found the ichthyosaur with one crediting the man who bought it from her, the Lord of the Manor of Lyme Regis, Henry Host Henley. Men usurping Mary's accomplishments became a running theme in her life, starting with this, her first major discovery of an almost complete ichthyosaur when she was only 12 years old. Mary Anning was born in Lyme Regis in May of 1799, when geology was a brand new natural science and Georgians were becoming more and more fascinated by fossils, a trend that would continue with the Victorians. The beaches around Lyme Regis on the Dorset coast of England are particularly perfect places for fossil collecting due to the thick layers of Jurassic and Cretaceous marine sediments and the continual action of the wind and waves, and especially winter storms, that expose 2 to 3 feet of fresh rock each year. I mean, I have Mesozoic envy. I live in the land of Paleozoic bedrock, and while I love trilobites, there are no ammonites or vertebrate fossils in my geological hometown. Mary, on the other hand, was born and lived all her life in a land that used to be a Jurassic sea. Jurassic aquarium, anyone? Mary's father, Richard Anning, a carpenter by trade, took her and her brother, Joseph, out on the Lyme shores and up the cliffs of the Blue Lias Formation and the Black Venn landslip, very dangerous, to hunt for ammonites and other fossils. He died in 1810 after a long illness following a tumble down the Black Ven when he ventured home from Charmouth one night. He left his pregnant wife and two children with debt and no source of income until Mary sold an ammonite to a rich lady on the beach. And they eventually expanded from Richard's table covered with fossils for tourists to a fossil shop. When Joseph discovered the ichthyosaur head in 1811, which he and others called a crocodile, Mary was determined to find the rest of it and did so a year later. They sold it to Lord Henley for £23, an enormous sum to them at the time, and now the skull is on display in the Natural History Museum of London with proper attribution. Mary became famous in Lyme but was thought to be a lucky one-hit wonder until she discovered the first nearly complete plesiosaur fossil in December 1823 and supposedly worked through the night in the freezing cold to extricate it from its muddy prison, the Black Ven. This was an extremely hazardous task in an area known for its landslides and within a landslide itself. 0 out of 10 do not recommend, especially by oneself and at night. Ammonite illustrates the danger and the gooiness in these scenes when Mary slides down the cliff after freeing an ammonite boulder. Good thing it did not strike her in the head. And when Charlotte and Mary dig in the sediment, lay down almost 200 million years ago and now soft again after exposure to the rain and waves. And they get it all over themselves. The kids in the day camps I used to teach loved smearing even older Ordovician clay all over their faces when we'd find it in creek beds in the woods, much to their parents' dismay. I definitely sensed Charlotte's delight in the stuff in the movie, probably because she, like the kids in the camp, didn't have to do their own laundry. The Reverend William D. Conybear presented Mary Anning's plesiosaur to the Geological Society of London, thereby laying intellectual claim to it, and not even naming Mary, just calling her the proprietor, and blaming her method of assembling the bones for his early misinterpretation of the fossils. Georges Cuvier, the famous French naturalist and founder of vertebrate anatomy, at first expressed doubt about the authenticity of the plesiosaur fossil, threatening the Annings' reputation and livelihood. A convening of the Geological Society to render a verdict on the subject came out in Mary's favor, and Cuvier had to admit he was wrong. Mary also found the first British pterosaur, Dimorphodon macronax, meaning two-formed tooth and big clawed, in December 1828. This was an exceedingly rare find, a flying reptile in marine sediments. Mary's friend, the geologist and professor William Buckland, described the find for the Geological Society and even named her as the discoverer in his speech. But since she had only found it and sold it, and also because she was a lower class woman, he was credited with its description and presentation. A similar situation occurred with coprolites, or fossilized feces, which appear in ammonite. Mary Anning and William Buckland were friends and colleagues, and Mary wrote to him and his wife and enjoyed seeing them and their children in Lyme. Mary and William traipsed the shores near Lyme many times over the years, scouring the cliffs and the beach for fossils and discussing their finds with each other. Some of the coprolites were found in the abdominal areas of ichthyosaur fossils and contained fragments of other ichthyosaurs, meaning ichthyosaurs ate ichthyosaurs. Mary put forth her hypothesis about the coprolites to her friend, and Buckland agreed and published the first paper on them in the Transactions of the Geological Society in 1829, a publication Mary was unable to contribute to given her gender, social status, and lack of university education. She also helped Buckland characterize preserved ink sacs in fossilized cephalopods like the belemnites in her sketchbook in this scene, relating them to modern squids and nautilus, and further feeding ideas about evolution to naturalists like Charles Darwin. Mary's other major discoveries include a new species of fish, Squalorhaja, in December 1829, another species of plesiosaur, Plesiosaurus macrocephalus, in December 1830, and a huge ichthyosaur, Temnodontosaurus platyodon, in 1832. She did not get the pleasure or the accolades that came with officially presenting them to the scientific community, describing them in scientific letters, or even naming them. She sold them all in order to survive. Mary was famous and respected among British scientists, and as she told the King of Saxony's entourage visiting her fossil shop in Lyme, quote, "I am well known throughout the whole of Europe." unquote. But she did not receive official recognition for her work until after her death. Gideon Mantell wrote of her in 1832, quote, "We sailed out in quest of Mary Anning, the geological lioness of the place. She, the presiding deity, a prim, pedantic, vinegar-looking, thin female, shrewd and rather satirical in her conversation," unquote. Okay, dude, way to focus on her appearance. But wealthy naturalists sought her out because, as John Murray wrote, quote, "A single glance at the edge of a fossil peeping from the blue lias revealed to her the nature of the fossil, and its name and character were instantly announced," unquote. Thomas Allen, a Scottish mineralogist, wrote in 1824, quote, "Mary Anning, the geologist of this place, is a very interesting person, and the scientific are entirely indebted to her for the preservation of some of the finest remains of a former world that are known in Europe. Mary Anning's knowledge of the subject is quite surprising. She is perfectly acquainted with the anatomy of her subjects, and her account of her disputes with Buckland, whose anatomical science she holds in great contempt, was quite amusing," unquote. Mary was not afraid to speak her mind to her male and wealthy visitors. As she wrote to Charlotte Murchison in 1829, quote, "I do so enjoy an opposition among the bigwigs," unquote. She knew more than they did based on her voracious reading and copying of any scientific tracts to come her way, but mostly her practical experience in the field. She was out on the beaches of Lyme almost every day, and as I tell my students, the more you look at fossils and rocks, the easier it is to interpret them. Mary Anning was the best at reading Lyme rocks and fossils. In the 1820s and 1830s, she freely shared her knowledge, enabling rich male scholars to use her to further their careers and incomes, mostly without any attribution. Mary Anning was friends, or at least in a visiting and writing relationship, with many of the early 19th century geologists, including the above-mentioned Buckland and Charles Lyell, Henry de la Beach, Louis Agassiz, who named some fish species after her, and of course, Sir Roderick Impey Murchison, who appears in Ammonite as the husband of Charlotte, Mary's eventual love interest, at least in the film. The film takes place in the early 1840s, but Mary first met the Murchisons in the early 1820s when they visited Lyme specifically for its fossils and famous fossilist. Charlotte, born in 1788 and more than a decade older than Mary, was feeling tired during their visit, but this was due to the malaria she contracted and survived during a visit to Rome with her husband years earlier. She suffered from its after effects for the rest of her life. Roderick did indeed leave his beloved Charlotte in Lyme to, as he put it, quote, "become a good practical fossilist by working with the celebrated Mary Anning of that place," unquote. Mary developed a seemingly easygoing relationship with her wealthy friends based on their letters to and from Charlotte, who advertised Mary's expertise and fossil finds to prospective buyers in scientific circles, and commissioned the fossilist herself.
Charlotte. On top of this sheer hard work, let us not forget the knowledge and years of skill Miss Anning brings to her tasks. Without this, and to the untrained or ill-formed eye, these would simply be uninvestigated lumps of stone and rock.
Mary wrote to her in 1824 that, quote, "I am also greatly obliged to your kindness in mentioning my skeletons to different collectors," unquote. Taken out of context, that is a bizarre line. Charlotte invited Mary to stay with them in London in 1829, and Mary wrote, quote, "Should anything occur to prevent my accepting it, it will be the death of me," unquote. Something did prevent her at first, a missent letter or other miscommunication, but she did eventually go and presumably stayed with the Murchisons. But she does not really mention other people in her diary entries of her visits, so much as the places and the things that she observed. Mary was friends with and admired both of the Murchisons. She wrote to Charlotte that she'd heard, presumably from Buckland, that Roderick, quote, "looked like a god," unquote, while giving a geology talk, quote, "which I most cordially believe, for he is certainly the handsomest piece of flesh and blood I ever saw," unquote. Well, okay. When Roderick was knighted by Prime Minister Robert Peel in 1846, Mary wrote him a poem called Encomium Murchisonarum First. It is a delightful poem filled with geological allusions, including the lines, "Who calculated nature's shocks and proved the low Silurian rocks detritus of more ancient blocks, Sir Roderick? Who knows of what all rocks consist and sees his way where all is missed about the metamorphic schist, Sir Roderick?" In Ammonite, Murchison is a controlling husband frustrated with his wife's depression, perhaps due to a miscarriage or their inability to get pregnant, or just clinical depression, which of course would not have been diagnosed at that point. The couple never had children, but I think this misrepresents what appears from all historical accounts to be a loving marriage. Roderick did not long survive his beloved wife when she died in 1869. The film also misrepresents Charlotte Murchison, and not just her age difference with Mary Anning. Charlotte was interested in geology before Roderick, and as their science writer friend Mary Somerville wrote, she was, quote, an amiable and accomplished woman, drew prettily, and, what was rare at the time, she had studied science, especially geology, and it was chiefly owing to her example that her husband turned his mind to those pursuits in which he afterwards obtained such distinction, unquote. Charlotte did not just draw prettily, she pushed her husband to study geology so he wouldn't devolve into the stereotypical gentleman of leisure, only interested in fox hunting and horses. She illustrated many of her husband's published papers and works, and her collection of fossils was so well kept and labeled that others studied and published papers on it. Men, of course. In honor of her contributions to geology, James Sowerby, a conchologist, named a fossil after her, Ammonites Murchisonae. Here is her sketch of it. Charlotte even argued for the scientific education of women, convincing Charles Lyell to admit her and other women into his lectures. Both Charlotte and Mary were doing geology. They made sketches, an important form of data in geology. They took notes, discussed their ideas with others, and influenced other geologists. Because they were women, they were unable to join scientific societies and publish their work. And while I so appreciate that the Ammonite film presents an interesting alternate history, by glossing over these accomplishments, it does participate in their continued erasure from general public knowledge. Mary and Charlotte were not the only intelligent women to collect and study fossils in Lyme. Mary befriended not only the men who came to learn from her, but also their wives and children, many of whom were just as interested in geology, like Mary Lyell and Mary Buckland. Lots of Marys. The wealthy Elizabeth Philpott, played by Fiona Shaw in Ammonite, lived in Lyme with two of her sisters, was a serious fossilist in her own right, and went out on the beach with Mary almost daily. The two were good friends despite the 20-year age gap and difference in social class. Elizabeth encouraged Mary to read geological texts and understand more deeply the science behind fossils. Geologists visited the Philpotts collection and consulted Elizabeth for her expertise on fossil fish. When Mary discovered fossilized ink sacs in belemnites, it was Elizabeth who figured out that the ink could be reconstituted with water and used in drawings. In an 1828 letter to Charlotte, Mary wrote, quote, "You and Mr. de la Beach have given me green sand mania. Both as Miss Philpott and myself have been beating bits of green sand to pieces to find shells, and after our return, we sit down and turn over the leaves of Sowerby until our poor heads is a complete jumble of bivalves, univalves, etc." Unquote. A few weeks later, she wrote, quote, "I soon lost the green sand mania and returned to my old passion for bones." Unquote. The Philpotts were also known for their homemade wound salve, which appears in the film. They purportedly gave it to anyone who asked. Mary also became friends with several younger women and got them interested in geology, or at least took them out to hunt fossils. She met Frances Augusta Bell in 1824 when Miss Bell's mother brought her to Lyme for her health. The 14-year-old went on the beach with 25-year-old Mary to collect fossils and take the sea air, and wrote of her older friend that she was, quote, a congenial spirit, a perfect mistress of the science of mineralogy and fossils, unquote, and that she was, quote, much noticed by the ladies of the place, unquote. Perhaps they noticed Mary because she was engaging in what was considered man's work and transgressed the boundaries of the heterosexual hierarchy in more ways than one. Because of her confidence and her scientific understanding, because of her unusual appearance and her many layers and shellacked hat, or all of the above, Mary's letters to Frances reveal her more emotive, religious, and motherly side, and her sympathy and care for the sick that I think shows up in how she takes care of her mother and Charlotte in Ammonite. Anna Maria Penny was another young friend of Mary Anning's, and thank goodness for journals, because Miss Penny wrote a lot about Mary, including the line, quote, "I really love Mary Anning," unquote. When they first met in Lyme, Anna Maria's mother insisted a chaperone go with her on her fossil walks with Mary. Quote, as she was afraid to trust me alone with this extraordinary character. Why, I do not know. End quote. While out fossil hunting, presumably after her mother decided Mary was trustworthy, Anna Maria was almost caught by the tide, and Mary grabbed her around the waist and carried her to safety. In 1832, Anna Maria recorded in her journal a line legend of Mary finding a dead body of a beautiful woman on the beach in 1815. Apparently, Mary removed all of the seaweed and other detritus from the corpse, and when it was laid out in a church waiting to be claimed, she brought fresh flowers to place around it. The woman turned out to be Lady Jackson, the victim of a shipwreck when returning from India. Anna Maria concluded that Mary's actions were evidence of her, quote, wild romance, unquote, an emotional side that would occasionally surface and not be contained regardless of propriety or expectations for women. Miss Penny also wrote of Mary in 1831 that, quote, she says the world has used her ill and she does not care for it. And according to her, these men of learning have sucked her brains and made a great deal by publishing works of which she furnished the contents, while she derived none of the advantages, unquote. Indeed. And we see this bitterness in Kate Winslet's portrayal of Mary Anning. Despite her fame, Mary and her mother, Molly Anning, were struggling financially in the 1830s and 40s due to the decline and general interest in fossils. What? And increased competition with other fossil collectors. A few of Mary's advocates tried to help, including her friend Henry de la Beach, who illustrated his conception of the Jurassic Sea over Dorset, Dura Antiquator, or Ancient Dorset. Proceeds from the sale of the lithograph went to support Mary and her mother. The British Association for the Advancement of Science arranged for an annuity by raising £200 through subscription, and the government contributed another £300, and starting in 1838, the Anning women received about £25 a year. It was not enough, and Mary had to continue the arduous and dangerous work of collecting fossils and shells to sell to support herself and her mother. Molly Anning did indeed lose at least 8 children, either soon after birth, within the first year, or horrifically, 1 4-year-old daughter in a kitchen fire. Molly died in 1842, at which point Mary copied the Henry Kirke White poem, Solitude, in one of her notebooks. It is that I am alone, yet in my dreams a form I view, that thinks on me and loves me too. I start, and when the vision's flown, I weep that I am all alone. Mary was diagnosed with breast cancer in 1846, and that same year, the Geological Society of London, where many of her major finds were first announced, collected a stipend for her and made her an honorary member. But it was too late for her to travel to London and attend a meeting and receive the recognition she was due in person. She was gravely ill and died in March of 1847. Thomas Hawkins wrote in his memoirs of Mary and her valuable help to de la Beach, Conybeare, Buckland, and many others, quote, it must never be forgotten how much the exertions of Miss Anning of Lyme contributed to assist them. This lady, devoting herself to science, explored the frowing and precipitous cliffs there when the furious springtide conspired with the howling tempest to overthrow them, and rescued from the gaping ocean, sometimes at the peril of her life, the few specimens which originated all the fact and ingenious theories of those persons whose names must ever be remembered with sentiments of liveliest gratitude, unquote. Mary was caught in between social classes and gender expectations, associating with the wealthy academic elite while remaining relatively impoverished herself, and doing what was considered man's work when women were expected to radiate modest femininity. Perhaps her low class and unmarried status enabled her to spend most of her days on the rocks or reading and learning about them and the stories she could interpret from their fossils, sediments, and structures. I think it is crucial to include her and other women geologists, usually subsumed beneath the scientific accomplishments of the men they assisted to greatness in all levels of scientific education. Mary Anning never lost the joy in fossils shared by the majority of young people, a joy I hope to inspire in my own students as I teach them about ammonites, giant sea reptiles, and also Mary Anning. And now I want to make an 1820s gown, maybe a Jurassic history-bounding version, and reenact the circumstances under which Mary and Charlotte really met. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video and learned something, please give it a thumbs up and let me know what you think in the comments. If you want to see more forays into historical figures, 18th and 19th century culture and literature, or the history of costume, please subscribe to my channel and give me suggestions for future topics in the comments. All of this helps me with YouTube's algorithm so I can get more support and keep making videos. Thank you.